Okay, let's continue on the quantum Hall effect. Just to recap a few of the essential things from the last lecture. Quantum Hall effect is a phenomenon which occurs when you have a two-dimensional, or effectively two-dimensional, system of electrons. So they're essentially confined to a plane, and they are in the presence of a strong magnetic field. And there is one very crucial variable number which we introduced, which is the filling factor nu, which is defined to be the number, I'll put an S on that, the number per on the surface, that is the number per unit area, times H over EB. And typically for the quantum Hall effect, you're interested in cases where this filling factor, remind you, this is the number of electrons per flux quantum. That's probably the easiest way to remember it, but. And very typically, when you're dealing with the quantum Hall effect, you're interested in cases where this number is of order one. This is in strong distinction to the situation which traditionally occurs in condensed matter physics, when nu is of the order of 10 to the 3 or 10 to the 4. Okay. Remember that another possible definition, apart from a factor of order one, is of nu, is that it's of the order of the Fermi energy of the system you're talking about, divided by the cyclotron, Fermi energy divided by the cyclotron energy. And as I say, typically in the traditional Shubnikov de Haas kind of effects, this is going to be of the order of 10 to the 3 or 10 to the 4, so you're not in the quantum Hall regime. But we're interested in nu of order 1. A second quantity, which is going to play an important role, which let me just remind you of, is the so-called magnetic length, defined by Lm is equal to H over Eb to the 1/2. And the interesting thing about that is that it's completely independent of the material's characteristics. It doesn't depend on the effective mass of the quasiparticles. It doesn't depend on the screening of the Coulomb interaction or anything like that. So it's just a fundamental constant and the magnetic field B. And crudely speaking, apart from a factor of order one, Lm is the radius of the area which contains a flux quantum. To be more precise, the area occupied by a flux quantum is actually 2 pi times Lm squared, so that's twice the area of a circle of radius, Lm. As a mnemonic, for B of the order of 1 Tesla, so typical magnetic field used in these experiments, the magnetic length is ordered 250 angstroms. So large compared to any characteristic microscopic length in your problem. Okay, let me also just remind you about what we know about the motion of free electrons, non-interacting rather than free, the motion of non-interacting electrons in electric and magnetic fields. The electric field is essentially a special case of some kind of spatially dependent potential. Right? So we can actually generalize to that. What's going to happen classically to a particle which is moving, a charged particle moving in a magnetic field in the presence of some kind of spatially varying potential, is that it's going to move in a plane perpendicular to the magnetic field. In our case, this is a sort of trivial condition because you're always, generally speaking, you're always in the plane perpendicular to the magnetic field. If by any chance the magnetic field is tilted, well, as regards orbital effects, at least, you only need to consider the perpendicular component. So, but normally the magnetic field is perpendicular anyway. So that condition is trivial. But the interesting point is that the particle is going to move along lines of constant potential, right? And equipotential contours, perpendicular to the magnetic field. So this applies not just to a spatially constant electric field, but also to more interesting situations where, for example, you might get potentials due to impurities and so forth. And a very important point that's going to be absolutely crucial in the discussion of this lecture is that these equipotential contours may or may not be extended throughout the system. You may find, if you're crudely speaking, if you're at an energy which is comparable, which is on the general scale of the fluctuations of potential in your system, then you're going to get at least some contours which are spatially extended throughout the system. On the other hand, if you're at low or high energies, then these contours are going to be restricted to particular regions. For example, if you have a single impurity which has a very deep potential, then the contours which have an energy low, which have a very low energy, are going to be confined in the region of that potential. Similarly, if I have a region of very high potential, then there are going to be contours of high energy which are confined and circulating basically around that potential.
This is only for non-interacting?
For the moment, we're talking about non-interacting electrons, yes.
The reason that they're confined to these contours is because they can't dissipate their energy to one another? Right.
We're dealing, for the moment at least, with a conservative problem. Even in the presence of the magnetic field, then energy is conserved. Yep. So in some sense, that's why you move on a contour of constant potential. Now, let me just, I'm going to have to deal with this in a little more detail later, but let me just again remind you of a result which we actually discussed rather briefly in the last lecture, which is the quantum mechanical generalization of this statement. Okay, so, well, remember in quantum mechanics, there is a complication because you have the choice of various possible gauges, and because of the huge degeneracy of the states, this tends to give you the possibility of various representations of your single particle wave functions. But one useful representation, for which typically you'd use the so-called Landau gauge, is that the quantum mechanical. Suppose I have a classical problem in which I've got an electron which has a given energy and is moving along a particular equipotential. And let's just, for the sake of a moment, argument, assume the potential is the contour is closed. So classically, the electron is circulating along this equipotential contour here. Now, crudely speaking, what's it going to do quantum mechanically? Well, one possible representation at least is that there's going to be a quantum mechanical state which, crudely speaking, averages over this classical motion. And this is a sort of rather general, I guess hand-waving, but rather general situation. Whenever you have a classical problem and the quantum mechanical problem is in some sense in a reasonably quasi-classical limit, then you can think of the quasi-classical wave function as basically averaging over the classical motion. So, for example, that happens at the ground state of the harmonic oscillator. Okay, you've got a classical motion in which the thing is going backwards and forwards. In quantum mechanics, the wave function, in some sense, is an average over that motion. And same here. I'm sorry?
I missed your last word. Can you say the wave function?
Averages over that motion. And it's the same here. So, crudely speaking, there's going to be a quantum mechanical state which has a non-zero probability amplitude all around this contour, right? Now, what's going to be the extent perpendicular to the contour? Well, it always turns out, and this is something which I did discuss briefly, but probably perhaps too briefly in the last lecture, and you might want to go through the notes again on this. Crudely speaking, it turns out that the width around this contour is in fact constant around the contour and is simply the magnetic length. It's magnetic length Lm. Okay. So, So basically, that's what happens in the quantum mechanical description. Again, if the classical equipotential motion is extended, then you would expect your quantum mechanical states will also be extended throughout the whole sample. But some of them, at least, will be localized. They'll circulate around regions of high or low potential.
Can we expect a periodic solution around this loop? I mean, by the boundary conditions, we should expect some it seems strange to say an average, but
yeah.
Expect peaks and troughs, you know.
There is an important point here that it turns out this remember that in the classical classical case there was actually a characteristic drift velocity at which the electron is moving, which is essentially E over B, the electric field divided by the magnetic field. And it turns out that in quantum mechanics, if you calculate the current operator for this kind of state, it will correspond to that. In other words, it will be E times V, times a probability density, which we'll have to come back to later. But,
so then you don't have two counter-moving electrons, so you don't get the kind of
interference. No, that's a good point. One very important point, which is crucial to the quantum Hall effect, in general, is that you have broken the time reversal invariance here, and therefore the motion is very definitely in this sense and not in the reverse sense. Okay. Let me remind you of one last thing from the last lecture before we go on to something new. Remember that we had this so-called Corbino disk. We consider this so-called Corbino disk geometry, which is just the, crudely speaking, it's just the geometry of a CD disk. So a large circular plate with a hole in the middle. And what we're going to do is to consider the situation where we have, first of all, a uniform magnetic field, B, out of the plane of the blackboard. And that B extends, of course, over the region of the metal itself, but also through the hole here. Okay, it's typical. I mean, in real life, it's rather difficult to get your magnetic field to vary over small spatial dimensions. So it's a good approximation to think of it as constant over the whole region here. But we are going to allow ourselves. And this is, in some sense, more for theoretical convenience than something which is experimentally very realistic. And we're going to allow ourselves also to put in an Aharonov bone flux through the hole. Does everyone understand what I mean by an Aharonov bone flux? It means simply that I have configured my magnetic fields due to this, so that they exist only in the hole. So there's no magnetic field associated with this out here, but there will be a vector potential, of course, associated with it in the standard way. Okay, so if we consider this geometry here and ask what is a possible choice of the single particle states, well, for this it turns out it's the so-called radial gauge, which is the most useful one. And what we find is that we can characterize these states by two quantum numbers. The wave function will be a function of the radial distance, r out here, and the angle theta around the loop. And the first quantum number basically characterizes the so-called Landau level. That is, it's basically the n which occurs in the n plus a half h bar omega c in the expression of the energy. It's the second one, in some sense, the more interesting one. This wave function turns out to have the following form, right, on theta, if SHO of n of r minus r sub l. By this I mean it's the nth excited simple harmonic oscillator state. We'll be mostly interested in the case where n equals zero here, the ground state. But the important point is that for given L, it's a function of R minus RL. And what is RL? Well, RL, the easiest way of remembering what RL is that it is the radius at which you enclose, which a circular orbit encloses exactly L flux quanta, or quanta of flux. Now that's not trivial, because remember that the total flux within a circle of radius R is going to have two contributions. It's going to have the contribution from the uniform field B, which remember also penetrates the hole here, but it's also going to have a contribution from the AB flux. And so the actual formula for RL is 2 times L minus phi AB over phi 0 to the half times L sub m, the magnetic length here. I actually have this formula in the notes of the last lecture, but I guess I didn't put a subscript AB on the flux, which might be that's slightly confusing. So now, as I say, so you have a wave function which has this angular dependence, and then its radial dependence is sharply peaked around this value RL. And again, as it always turns out in the quantum Hall effect, the radial extent of this wave function is of the order of the magnetic length. Okay. So in fact, what you're going to get a very large number of states with different L strongly overlapping. As I go to, you have a picture. Well, I think you have it here. You have it in the notes of the at the end of the last the notes of the last lecture. You have a picture of how these different L states are distributed, and as you go to larger and larger L, they get closer and closer together, and they're very, very crowded on the scale of the magnetic length. Okay. Nevertheless, so you might think, we raised this point briefly at the end of the last lecture, you might think that means that they can't be mutually orthogonal, but that's where the e to the IL theta comes in. That will make them orthogonal.
We're making the assumption that there are sufficient, that the flux quanta are sufficiently dense to allow for this kind of wave function, because we're saying...
Oh, yeah. Right. I mean, if I were to take the limit of very, very tiny field, then of course I'd find that even the whole disk couldn't enclose one flux quantum, and then I guess we'd have to discuss it differently.
And then also we're assuming that that they're spread out in some uniform way. Basically.
Well, yes, but I mean that's not really an assumption. That's what you get from the solution of the equation.
Right.
Yep. Mm. Okay. One further, very, very crucial remark. These states, that they okay, do they carry any current? You see, remember, in general, we find when we had a spatially varying potential, we found that the states did, for example, this kind of situation, we find the states did carry a circulating current. But here we don't actually have any variation of the spatial potential. We've just assumed implicitly that the disk is sort of free space, as it were. Right, so we wouldn't expect any current at first sight. And can we actually verify that? Well, it's fairly obvious that since this is in the R direction, we simply have a simple harmonic oscillator wave function, right? That clearly doesn't carry any current in any particular direction, right? So there's no radial current. What about the slightly more trickier point? What about the angular current? Do these states correspond, states of this type, correspond to a circulating current? And the answer is no. That's because, crudely speaking, the center of the orbit encloses exactly L quanta of flux. That L quanta of flux exactly cancels the L in here. To put it in a slightly different language, you have to remember that in the presence of a magnetic field, the canonical momentum is not equal to the kinematic momentum, and similarly for the angular momentum. So the canonical angular momentum is L, but when you calculate the kinematic angular momentum, call it at L kinematic with quotes on it, is equal to L minus the flux divided by phi zero. And and since you precisely tuned the position of your orbit to enclose exactly L quanta of flux, then that means you've got an exact cancellation there. So there's neither any radial nor any circulating current in this these states. Okay. You could do, yes. If, for example, I were to make up a wave packet which corresponded to superposition of different L, then because with appropriate phase factors, then yes, I could. You know. And in some sense, that's what's going to happen. You know. Okay, let me just stop at that point and just ask if there are any questions or comments about this, because I think these particular points are crucial for what I'm going to say the rest of this lecture. Okay, so then let's try to apply some of these ideas. So the argument I'm now going to give you for the integral quantum Hall effect is a very, very simple and very beautiful one, which is due to Halperin and Laughlin very soon after the initial experimental discovery. Yep. Yep.
Potential is an electric potential?
Well, it could be, but it doesn't really matter, because it all that matters really is how it comes into the Schrodinger equation. However, there is an important implicit assumption here, namely that the potential is not varying too fast on what scale. Now, that's a nasty question, actually. For the moment, let's assume it's slowly varying on the scale of the magnetic length. We may have to revise that.
Then.
Absolutely, yes. Yes, that's right. Yeah. Okay, so let's forget about this for a moment, and let's go to the Corbino disk geometry. The argument I'm going to give is a slight variant on the original Laughlin-Halperin one, which I think is slightly clearer than the original version, but it's essentially the same. Okay, so we imagine now that we not only apply a Hronov-Bohm flux through the sample, but also vary it slowly in time. So phi AB is going to be a function of time, and we'll imagine that we vary it on a pretty slow time scale. In particular, that time scale is going to be very slow compared to the inverse of the cyclotron frequency. That's not difficult because the cyclotron frequency typically is in the sort of terahertz range. So under these conditions, then we would tend to assume that the system does follow adiabatically, right? So it adjusts the state it's in adiabatically. Now you notice that this this classical orbit radius does contain phi AB here. So as I vary the AB flux, these contours, these classical orbits corresponding to given L, are going to move. And if I guess you have to think about the sine a little, but I guess if the sine of phi AB is parallel to that of B, then they will move outwards. But anyway, that's a detail. One way or the other, these contours are going to move. Right? Now, if and only if, a crucial reservation, if and only if there is exactly one electron occupying each of these levels, then the effect of this is that every time phi AB increases by a flux quantum, the pattern of levels will have moved out by one. The electron which is sitting in that level will have moved out. So one electron will have emerged off the outside of the disk, and one will have entered from the inside. Obviously, for this to work, you have to attach some leads to the inside and the outside. Okay, and And now you have to remember that by Faraday's law, if I vary the flux through this hole here, then that corresponds to the generation of an EMF around the ring. So there's going to be a voltage around the ring, V, which is minus d phi AB by dt. There's going to be a current which it corresponds to, what's it going to be? one point we have to remember is that I said let's imagine that each of these Landau levels here, each of these states, is occupied by a single electron. But actually, we can be a bit more general than that, because remember that we do have this index n here, which allows us to have more than one different harmonic oscillator state. So if we have an integral number of states occupied, then my argument still goes through. The current now, the current is going to be, I'll probably get the factors wrong, but it'll be the number n of occupied Landau levels times E times the times the rate at which d dt of, so I'll probably get this wrong since I'm doing it off the top of my head, phi ab of t divided by phi naught. Okay. I think this is going to come out right, surprisingly. So now you see phi naught is just a constant, E over H, so that's equal to n number of occupied levels times E squared over H times d phi by AB by dt. But we already saw d phi AB by dt is just the voltage. So that's n occupied times E squared over H times the voltage. Lo and behold, we've got out the integral quantum Hall effect. With what this is telling us, just putting it in a different language, remember the current is flowing this way, the voltage is this way around the circuit, so we're talking about it might be the other way around, it doesn't really matter. We're talking about the Hall conductivity, sigma xy. So what this tells us then is the result that sigma xy is equal to number of occupied levels times E squared over H, which is just the observed integral quantum Hall effect. However, if this were in some sense the whole of the argument, it in some sense really wouldn't be all that impressive. However, remember there was this crucial assumption that I have an integral number of Landau levels occupied. And I, in particular, that I don't, for example, have less than one Landau level occupied. If I, once I've got that, I can no longer assume that every time I change the Aharonov-Bohm flux by one flux quantum, that one electron is going to move out and another in there. It does rely crucially on the assumption that there's an integral number of Landau levels occupied. That would be fine, you see. I mean, that would be fine at those points at which the chemical potential just happens to be such that you do have an integral number of Landau levels occupied. But remember, if we go back to the free space case for a moment, that's very unlikely to happen. Because in the free space case, remember that you have this extreme degeneracy. You have your lowest Landau level has an energy a half h bar omega c, and your next one has three halves h bar omega c, etc., etc. And these are incredibly degenerate, something like 10 to the 23 of them. It's very unlikely if you just have a sort of arbitrary number of electrons sitting on these levels that you're going to get them exactly filled, right? So what's going on here? And the very beautiful answer which was given by, I think most clearly by Halperin originally, is rather surprising. It turns out that the integral quantum Hall effect is actually only there because of the effects of disorder. How does that work? Well, remember that I said that in general, if you have potential fluctuations in your sample, then some of your semi-classical states are going to be extended throughout the sample, and others are going to be localized. Now, there's a sort of rather generic argument that the states with lowest energy are going to be localized. They're going to be circulating around the regions of low potential. The states of intermediate energy are going to be delocalized, spread throughout the sample. And the states of high energy are again going to be localized, circulating around the peaks of the potential. So now imagine that this is following an argument due to Halperin. Imagine that just model this situation. And again, this is a sort of very standard argument in discussing the quantum Hall effect. Everything we know experimentally that things are sensitive only to the topology and not to details of the geometry. So that means that we can feel free to consider a geometry which might not be experimentally very realistic, but has the same topology as the realistic one. So we imagine that we have this ring here in which we've got a lot of impurities and therefore lots of fluctuations in the potential, and outside that we just have ordinary free space. And we consider the transport through this ring here. Well, you see, everything's going to depend on what happens to the extended states. The crucial point here, the Aronoff-Bohm flux is applied through the hole here. Which orbits are going to be sensitive to that Aronoff-Bohm flux? Only those which actually extend all the way around the ring. Any states which are localized on a smaller scale, any states which say circulating around some peak here or around some valley here, are not going to be at all sensitive to the flux. So they're going to basically not contribute anything. It's going to be only the extended states which move out in the way that I describe. So imagine now that you've got a given configuration of impurities, say, and this is a diagram, to say we haven't redraw it, it's on page 3 of your notes. Let's look first at the first, the lowest Landau level, the one corresponding to n equals 0. Well, as I said, the states close to the bottom of the band are going to be strongly localized around valleys in the potential. Then we have the middle of the band, which is delocalized and extended. And finally, we're going to have the again, localized states near the top of the band. And so on, and we go up to the next level, roughly the same thing is going to happen, though, of course, the scale may be a little different there. And so now the crucial question is, where does the chemical potential, or the Fermi energy, lie? If the Fermi energy lies in the extended region, in any of the extended regions, then our argument is off, basically. We would not expect this argument to work. And we would expect the Hall conductance to be some kind of relatively arbitrary number, not this exact number given by this. If, on the other hand, our Fermi level happens to lie in one of the localized regions, yeah, or for that matter, in the space between the levels, well, that's actually very improbable. It would require an very exact conditions, but more, it's much more likely that the Fermi energy lies in one of the localized regions here, right? So if that's the case, then the number of electrons in the extended states in let's suppose, for example, it lies towards the top of the n equals zero band. Then all the extended states in the n equals zero band are going to be local, are going to be occupied. So our argument then does go through for this. Similarly, if we now move the chemical potential up so that it's in the top of the at the top of the n equals 1 band, then our argument again goes through, but now n number of occupied bands is 2. So we would expect then that we reproduce the experimentally observed pattern of the quantum Hall effect. In other words, that we plot nu along here. This is I should just comment, this is not quite the way the experimentalists usually plot things, but it's a more convenient way from my perspective. And we plot Rxy divided by E squared over H. Then we find that let's put a 1 here and a 2 here, 3 here. We found nothing particularly interesting happens at very low values of nu. But then as we move up to the point, if we start off from nu equals 0, you see, we're sitting in the bottom of the first band, but now there are no electrons in extended states. So we would actually expect in that case that we'd get 0 here. But that wouldn't be particularly surprising. That would just say we have just an insulator, right? So there's a zero Hall conductance. As we now move our chemical potential into the bottom of the extended region, we find that the Rxy goes up, and then when we get to the point where we go up into the top of the first Landau level band, we find now that the conditions for the quantum Hall effect are satisfied, and we get this plateau, and so forth. Okay, just as is seen experimentally. So this actually gives us the following rather surprising conclusion, that in some sense to get a good quantum Hall effect, that is to get a wide plateau here, we actually have to have a lot of disorder. In fact, if we have no disorder at all, as I said, we're basically just going to get no plateaus and just get a straight line.
By disorder, you mean sort of
like defects in material that produce fluctuations in the potential? Yes, anything that produces fluctuations in the potential, the electron sees. Yeah. So that, crudely speaking, is the Laughlin-Halperin explanation of the integral quantum Hall effect. I say it's a very simple argument, and very elegant, really. Let me just stop and ask if there are any questions or comments on that. Okay, that really is, in some sense, the guts of the whole thing, and much of the rest of what I'm going to say in this lecture is sort of embroidery or commentary on that. So, yeah.
Can you expand on, so if our Fermi level happens to be in the extended domain?
Yes.
Then what should our picture be of these, of how the RL,
well,
RLs are filled?
Well, I mean, they'll be filled in a sort of, you have to remember that at least within the kind of, if we neglect the disorder for a moment, then in fact these extended states are all degenerate. So basically the electrons could be sitting anywhere in them.
We just care that they're all filled, and if they're not all filled.
Yes, they're sort of distributed in some kind of relatively random way over the levels.
When there is a movement being generated, we're going to get some fractal.
Yes.
Yeah,
and then, in fact, what you, I think, although this is not something that will really work out of my head, but I think this is right, that if you now consider the effects of weak disorder on these extended states, you'd find it's very much similar to what you calculate in traditional condensed matter physics. That is, you'll get scattering from one level into another in a sort of fairly random kind of way. One point, incidentally, which may seem a little trivial, but is important, and will become important later with the fractional wave effect, is that within this picture, the remember the the integral quantum Hall effect essentially consists of two pieces of information. One is that Rxy behaves like this, but the other is that Rxx behaves like, crudely speaking, like this. Let me draw it in a different colour so it's clear. The other important piece of information is that Rxx behaves like this. In other words, in other words, Rxx, the longitudinal resistance, or conductance, let me plot the conductance rather than the resistance. This incidentally should be a sigma here. So sigma Xx, this guy here, that is non-zero exactly where you don't get the quantization of the Hall conductance. Right. So I think it's now rather trivial in the Laughlin-Halperin picture to see how that's coming out, because where you don't get the when you're on the quantum Hall effect plateau, then your chemical potential is lying within the region of localized states. So now there are no free states available close to the Fermi surface, and by the usual textbook arguments, you would expect therefore that the conductance is zero. Okay. On the other hand, if you're in the region where you don't get a quantization of Rxy, then this means your Fermi level is sitting somewhere in the extended region, and the usual textbook arguments would give you a finite conductance, which you would then try to, crudely speaking, you could try to calculate along the standard textbook lines. Okay. If there are any more questions on that, please don't hesitate to ask them, because I say that really is rather crucial, and everything else is embroidery on this. Okay, so let's now go on to a slightly different way of looking at the integral quantum Hall effect. In some sense, I think this doesn't really give you a lot more insight into what's going on as such, but it historically it's been very important, because it really placed the focused attention on what's going on at the edge of the sample rather than what's going on in bulk. You see, in some sense our argument here focused on not on what was going on near the edges, but what was going on in the bulk of the sample, how the levels were moving and so forth. So the alternative point of view really, as I say, focuses on the edge states. To do that, we really do need to say something about the nature of the possible extended states. So let's, for the moment at least, put aside the localized states, and take a finite sample, for example, one as shown on page 4, and the figure on page 4 of your notes. But for the moment, let's just assume that the delta V in the left-hand part of the diagram is zero. We're going to have to come back to that, but for the moment, let's assume that delta V is zero, and moreover, we can just detach the current leads as well. So we just have a simple, isolated piece of quantum Hall sample. Right? Now, what are the single particle states going to be like? Again, for the moment, neglect any kind of interaction effects and just concentrate on the single particle effects. Well, we know that in general, we're only going to get it in some sense a simple behaviour as long as the potential actually is flat. Well, it is flat over most of the sample. So over most of the sample, it really doesn't matter too much how we choose our basis for the Landau levels. We could choose any of the various gauges we've discussed, and it wouldn't make any difference. But close to the edge, we have to be a little more careful. And the convenient choice of gauge for this purpose is the Landau gauge, or generalisation of the Landau gauge. And so we get this picture, which I drew up and then erased, in which we have orbits Now, where are those orbits going to be? Well, we're basically interested in the orbits which go right around the sample edge. That's the only place where the potential is strongly varying. Okay, so we would expect these extended states, but now, as I say, they're not going around regions of high or low potential in the bulk, they're going around the edge of the sample. What can we say about these states? Well, I'll write down what we can say, although to justify it, it takes a little more work. So we have these, have a sample here. Okay, we have this sample. Again, it's not important that it be any very well-defined shape. We have these quantized states running around the edge of the sample. Again, very importantly, we've broken the time reversal symmetry so that an electron in these states is going to be always circulating in one direction and never in the other. Now, the area of the state has to be such. When I say the area of the state, I simply mean the what determines the distance between the different allowed states. That has to be given by the consideration that the total density of states which you want has got to be. Okay, let me start again. The effective area of my state has to be area per state. Has to be correspond to phi zero, the flux quantum, divided by b. Okay. So the distance between allowed states has to be that phi zero divided by bl. Remember that distance, just as in the Corbino disk case, this distance, what I mean by the distance between states here is, would correspond in the Corbino disk case to the distance between neighbouring orbits. That's much less in general than the actual spatial extent of the state, which is more than the magnetic length. So this distance here is typically much less than the magnetic length here. We also know, this is not obvious. It comes out of a semi-classical argument, and you can also justify it explicitly, as I did briefly in the last lecture. It's in the notes, but I didn't spend a lot of time on it. The velocity of an electron in this state is E over B. That means that, and the transverse. Now we have to be careful. The transverse extent of the states is now. Is independent of the position on the contour. So the probability density then is equal to L to the minus 1. And that then means that the current is equal to the probability density times the electron charge times this, which is N is EE divided by BL. And this then, if you compare that with this, call this delta y for the moment, then this is just EE delta y divided by phi zero. Delta y here says the distance, we have the distance between neighbouring states. So EE times this distance is just the energy difference between the classical energies of these two states. So in other words, EE times delta y is equal to EN plus 1 minus EN. And so at the end of the day, we get out the following very useful relation, that the current carried in a state N is simply equal to E over H times E n plus 1 minus E n. Okay, so that is actually consistent with everything we said about the Corbino disk case, because in the Corbino disk case, when you had no, when you weren't varying the external flux, then all the states were within your Landau level were degenerate. Slight notational complication here. I'm using n now in a different meaning. I was using it earlier. It's not this n here. It's just, perhaps actually we should call it something different. Let's call it ij. It's equal to ej plus 1 minus ej. Make it clearer. Yep. Okay. So in words, the current carried by a state in the quantum Hall effect, is apart from the factor of E over H, is just the difference between the energy of that state and the energy of its neighbour. Okay. Now, that then has the following consequence, that if I now look at a given region, near the edge of the sample for the moment, and I consider all the states which lie within this region, so I sometimes integrate over those, then what I find is that the delta I, the current carried by the states within that region, is just E over H times delta mu. So let's imagine that we're going back for the moment to the picture on top of page 4 of your notes. Let's imagine that we actually integrate between, as it were, a point where we're in the bulk at the bottom of the bottom of this trough on the right hand side of page 4, yeah? A point far out beyond the edge of the sample. at the edge of the at the edge of the sample, that is the last occupied state there. Then what we find is that if we measure the voltage between that point just at the edge of the sample and the bottom of the potential, the floor in this diagram, then we find that a current equal to delta mu, equal to E of H times delta mu, flows around the boundary. In most cases, the chemical potential can be just taken to be E times the voltage drop, that then gives us E squared over H times delta V. So that says that if I apply if I'm in a situation where there is a voltage drop or potential drop between the outside of the sample and the interior, then that corresponds to a current of this magnitude flowing around the boundary. So this means then that even when I've got no external voltage or current leads, remember I haven't yet put on any leads of any kind to this, even in this situation, I would expect to find a non-zero current flowing around the boundary there. Okay? So far so good? Okay. Now let's suppose that we actually apply as in the actual picture on the left-hand side of top of page 4 of your notes, let's assume that we actually apply a voltage between these two points here.
Is it at all surprising that we find a current flowing around the boundary?
No.
I mean, if we have a magnetic field, we should expect circulating
electrons. No, it's not surprising. No. however, as you'll see, there are in fact some subtleties which come in when we consider the effect of an external voltage applied. So if we now apply an external voltage, then you see our potential looks something like this. We've now still got this, but in fact the edge of the sample, as it were, occurs here at this point over here and at this point over here. So now the drop between here and here is not equal to the drop between here and here. That in turn means that the current flowing, so let's now at this point put our leads on explicitly. I'll take this off. Oh, I'll just redraw it. Okay. So now put my voltage leads on here. And I'll put my current leads on here. Okay, so now what's going to happen? So the voltage drop from here to here is now not the same as the drop from here to here. So now this current will not be equal to this current. So in other words, I'll get a current I1 here and a current I2 going down down here. And the difference of that current is clearly the total current through the circuit. Yeah. Okay. So, and again, by a very simple adaptation of the argument I just gave, you're going to find that for a single lambda level occupied, incidentally, I should say this does refer obviously to the case where I have a single lambda level occupied. If I had more than one, then I'd have to multiply by n in the standard way. What I get out of this argument is precisely the standard quantum Hall effect, but in a slightly different way. You see, rather than looking at what's happening in the bulk, we're looking now at what's happening on the edges of the sample, and it's possible to recast this argument as I've done in the written version of the notes. I won't spend a lot of time on it now, but it is possible to recast this argument in the Landauer language, in which you talk about you talk about possible channels, and the crudely speaking, the conductance of an arbitrary mesoscopic system is given by some kind of transmission coefficient, which is in general less than or equal to one for each channel. People do try to discuss it in that language, but I won't go into that here. Anyway, at the end of the day, you come out with. Sorry?
This is a question with the circulating current.
Oh, yeah.
Does it induce a self-magnetization?
Yes, it would, in general.
Does that affect results?
That's a good question. Okay, now my sort of off-the-cuff guess would be that that if you actually put the numbers in, you'd find that is a very tiny effect on the scale. But let's just think about that for a moment. An interesting point here is that the magnitude of this circulating current does depend on the potential drop between here and here, but it does not depend on the magnetic field, except insofar as that enters implicitly the number of occupied Landau levels and so forth. So let's see if we can do this off the top of our heads. I probably can't, but let me try. What is this likely to be? Well, we've got. I'm trying to put in some real numbers into this. E is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 SI units, isn't it? And H is 2 pi times 10 to the minus 34 SI units. So if I do it, let's see, the simple way probably is to, let's go ahead. So this is E squared is going to be 5 times 10 to the minus 38. It's going to, so this is going to be this factor here. Yes, it's going to be about 10 to the minus 4. So delta I in amps is going to be roughly 10 to the minus 4 times delta V in volts. What's delta V in volts? Well, typically the order of a few volts, probably. The difference in potential between the inside and outside of your sample, but say between vacuum and your sample. Right? So typically the circulating current then is going to be something like 10 to the minus 4 amps. Let's try to ask how large a magnetic field that's going to produce. Can everyone do this in their head? I'll probably lose some awful factor like the velocity of light if I try to do it in my head, but let's try. So I have this this current which is circulating in a loop of radius r, and my instinct would be that h will be of the order of I divided by r. And therefore the B, the magnetic induction, will be mu zero times I divided by R. R is the radius, not the resistance. Yeah. Okay. So what shall we take for the radius of our sample? Well, let's say a millimeter, say. So R in SI units is about 10 to the minus 3. Mu zero, typically, is about 4 pi times 10 to the minus 7, isn't it? Is that right? Remember? SI units? What's that? I forget, I wouldn't actually take my life on the 4 pi, but I think that's right. So that's about 10 to the minus 6. So we have 10 to the minus 6 times 10 to the minus 4, 10 to the minus 10 divided by R, 10 to the minus 7. So B is about, B induced is something like 10 to the minus 7 tesla, whereas the original field was typically something of the order of a few tesla. Yeah. However, I mean, it's not a trivial point, because after all, one is at some point going to be interested in using the quantum Hall effect for metrology, and therefore small variations could be significant. Now, I think the reason they're not is that the metrological uses of the quantum Hall effect relate to the actual quantum Hall conductance or resistance itself. Luckily, that doesn't depend on the magnetic field, at least within wide range. So hopefully, yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's an interesting point. Okay, let me. One question, which I think is worth just raising, because it's not something which is usually discussed. If you, at first sight, this point of view looks really rather straightforward. It simply says, qualitatively, if I have a large magnetic field on, so as to generate the quantum Hall effect, and I am on one of the plateaus, plateau regions, then in the absence of any kind of external leads, I just get this current flowing around the edge of the sample. In the presence of the leads, what happens is simply that the current along one edge is larger than the current return current off the other edge, and that is simply the total current flowing through the circuit. First sight, everything looks like very very neat and sewn up. This argument implicitly assumes that no current ever flows through the bulk of the material. And the question is that right? Almost all the standard review articles and textbooks assure you that's right. But first of all, I'm not convinced myself that the theoretical arguments are that strong, particularly when you take into account the possible effects of interactions. I think more importantly, it's not clear that that's what experiments is. It's very difficult to do these experiments, but there are some experiments which do seem to show that part of this external current does flow, or may flow, through the bulk of the sample, despite the fact that you still get the standard result for the resistance and so forth. So that's, I think, to my mind, that's a slightly unsettling unknown about the quantum Hall effect. We're still talking about the integral version. We haven't yet got onto the complications of the fractional one.
What happens if we attach a material to one
I think what you'd expect shortly is that in the absence of any kind of external, I mean, if all you've done is just to take this situation and put on some non-trivial bit of metal on the side, as it were, and a different bit, say, on this side here, then if you don't have any current leads, then the chemical potential is going to equilibrate itself between these two, and therefore the current down here will still be the same as the current up there. But of course, it would change the absolute value of the current for sure. If you had current leads, well then, then I think a lot would depend on under what conditions this is held. If there's no external voltage applied here, then. No, I think my instinct would be that again you get equilibration of the chemical potential, and therefore no induced. Okay. Yeah, you have to specify exactly what you're going to impose on the system and what you're going to leave it free to decide for itself. Okay. If you impose a current through the system, then what you'd expect, I think, is that you will actually induce a difference in chemical potential between these two. In other words, one sort of tends to assume, although it's not entirely obvious, this is always right, that if a given voltage produces if applying a voltage between these two, something which you control, as it were, causes a certain current to flow through the system, then conversely, applying the current will induce the voltage. That's at the mesoscopic level, that may not always be a totally correct assumption, actually. I think one does have to think about it sometimes. So it would be, basically what my implicit assumption in following through this argument was that it is delta mu or delta V which you control, as it were, and then you ask what current flow has to flow. But it would also be interesting to look at the inverse question. Suppose that delta I is what I control, am I then going to generate the appropriate delta V? And I think the general prejudice would be yes, but as I say, one has to be, it's not always trivial at a mesoscopic level to sort this out. Okay, for the final few minutes, let me just go on to a very beautiful, though slightly more complicated than anything we've done so far. This an argument which is due to Thallis and his collaborators. So far, we just shrugged our shoulders about any possible effects of interaction in the system. And it turns out that by doing so, we do appear to get a qualitative and even a sort of quantitative explanation of the quantum Hall effect. But you could well ask, well, wait a moment, isn't this all going to be screwed up by interactions? And the argument of Thallis and company is designed to get around that point. So it is more complicated, and you probably have to spend a little time outside the class following through the details of the algebra and so forth, but let's just have a brief look at it. So this is page 7, basically, of your notes. So you basically assume you have this circuit, which is shown in the figure, on top of page 7 of your notes. So in other words, you take both take this situation here, and you join up both the voltage and the current leads into loops. And you imagine that you can apply an Aharonov-Bohm flux through either of these loops separately. So I haven't actually said that in the notes explicitly, but you want to not only be able to apply an Aharonov-Bohm flux through the voltage loop, but also, in principle, through the current loop. I don't know. I think there's been a problem with the actual typesetting in here. This first formula, equation 8, in your notes, should have read. Yep.
Before you raise, I was wondering, is it a coincidence that if the sample is of the size of the magnetic length, uh-huh, then the induced magnetic field is comparable to the...
Oh, very good question. That hasn't occurred to me. Let's see. Yes, indeed, if we make it, R is going to shrink down by something like 6 orders of magnitude, yeah. I suspect it, my gut instinct is that it probably is a coincidence, because simply for the reason that you've got a mu zero occurring in this formula, which as it were doesn't occur anywhere else in the quantum Hall effect. And so I'm not entirely sure that I see how that could be cancelled, but I'd like to think about that actually. It's a good question. Okay, so yeah, equation, can I erase that? Yeah, thanks. So the equation, which hasn't come out quite right, is that sigma h is the real part of the correlation, the response function of 1 over I omega, times IV IJ of omega. This is the linear response function, which expresses the response of the current IJ to the current IV. So, oh well, you've got these square blocks which were not intended. No. Oh, hang on. I may be looking at the wrong thing. I beg your pardon. I was looking at the preliminary version which came out on my printer. And didn't, no, it's fine. And yours. Good. It's fine then. Saves some problems. So anyway, you now just write out this this response function in terms of matrix elements in the sort of standard way and get equation 9. There is a sort of rather simple formula which says that you can relate that. Remember, you're treating in this argument, you're treating the flux which you apply, the Aronoff-Bohm flux which you apply through the voltage loop, as something which you control. So it's a parameter here. And similarly, for you may want to think of the Aronoff-Bohm flux through the current loop in a similar way. And so you can relate this. The change in the Hamiltonian as a function of this parameter to the change in the wave function. That's equation 10. You can now write the expression for the Hall conductance in the form of equation 11. And now let's integrate that relation over phi j and phi v, over both phi j and phi 0 from 0 to 2 pi. So what you end up with is that the average expression, the average Hall conductance, is given by formula 12. Now, the only problem is, and this is a very, very essential and delicate point, I think, we do have to assume at this point that the ground state returns to its original value, other than possibly an overall phase factor of 2 pi, 2 n pi, when phi j has gone round one loop and phi v has gone round one loop. So this is, crudely speaking, the same argument as I used implicitly in the Corbino disk argument. You remember that I did implicitly assume that when I'd put one extra flux quantum through my Corbino disk, all that happened was that the states had moved out by one. Right? But nothing more complicated than that had happened. That was an assumption, which I didn't make quite explicit, but it was there. And it's basically the same assumption that's being made here. Now, once you've got that, that is really rather nice, because it turns out that this quantity, this rather nasty-looking quantity in equation 12, is something which, according to rather general theorems of topology, has to be equal to 2 pi times an integer. And the integer is said to define the so-called first Chern class of a mapping from phi j and phi v to psi 0. This is, in some sense, the integer you're talking about is sort of reminiscent, at least, of the so-called winding number, which occurred. You remember, I think the first lecture of this course, I actually talked briefly about the problem of stability of helium-4, superfluid helium-4 in a loop, and I made the analogy that you can think of the phase of your condensate wave function as like a string which is round a hula hoop, and the winding number is then simply the number of turns made by the string as I go once around the loop. Right? And basically, this is a generalization of that idea. So, although I mean, it's not true. It's an important piece of modern mathematics. In fact, it does turn out that provided always that psi zero comes back to its original value. That is, in the helium analogy or the string analogy, provided the string is tied back together again, as it were, then. Then in fact that is an integer times 2 pi. And as a result, you get that the average value of the Hall conductance, at least, is given by n e squared over h. So.
Can anyone ask what happens
to the
imaginary number
I there? Sorry? Actually, it should almost certainly be, yes, 2 pi I. It should be 2 pi I, I'm fairly sure, times an integral in here. Maybe minus y, yes, yeah. But in any case, n is sort of not defined up to a sign. So I do like this argument. I think it's a very, very neat one, and it's a very interesting question, which hopefully we can come back to next week, as to whether you could actually generalize this argument to the fractional quantum Hall effect. Thallis doesn't, in fact, in his original paper, even though the fractional effect was well known by the time he wrote this paper, so he obviously didn't see it as entirely straightforward to generalize it, but it looks as if it might perhaps be possible to do that. But you see what's really nice about this argument, as in fact is the case with most successful topological arguments, is that it's completely insensitive to, well, just about everything in sight, really. It's insensitive to whether you've got impurities in your system. It's insensitive as to whether you've got interactions and the nature of those interactions, etc., etc.
So it's insensitive to the impurities. We've seen that the impurities are critical in order to make this occur. So how can we
square this to? Oh, okay. Good. Well. As I said, it is essential assumption in this argument that when you've varied the flux through your voltage loop and through your current loop in the way that as described, you've come back to the same state. Now, you see, if you just go back to the Corbino disk argument for a moment, again, we made that same argument, that you basically have to be able to come back to the same state. That is not going to be the case if you're in the extended, if you're in the region away from the plateaus, if you're in the extended, if your chemical potential is in the extended region of the spectrum. You can't then, I mean, basically, you see, what's nice about the about the plateau region of the integral quantum Hall effect is that in some sense there's nowhere for the electrons to go except stay in these this set of extended states.
What happens when your Fermi surface is in the extended?
Well then I guess that what fails is the assumption that you must come back to the same point, the same value. In fact, you see, if you think about it, you're varying. You're varying your flux. You're creating a voltage. If your Fermi level lies in the extended region, then particles may get pushed by the voltage from an occupied state into an unoccupied one. And then in turn they may get scattered by impurities and so forth. So basically, qualitatively at least, the situation looks the same as a standard textbook account of conduction in that region. In the region where the chemical potential is lying in the localized region, all those states are sort of automatically blocked. And what's surprising is that they can do anything interesting at all, but as you see, they do.
Okay.
Okay, so any general questions, comments, whatever. So that's what I wanted to say really about the integral quantum Hall effect, at least at first sight. Apart from this rather tricky question, which the textbooks do tend to sweep under the rug about where the current actually flows, I think it looks like everything is sort of fairly well tied together. And although, okay, we don't have, of course, necessarily a detailed theory of the effect of interactions, at least the Thouless argument seems to guarantee us that they're not going to change these standard results. Any further questions or comments on that? Yeah.
Does spin degree of freedom play any role in integral?
Yeah. Good question. Yeah. The answer is yes. But in a slightly indirect way. What happens is that, first of all, you might ask, does the spin orbit interaction play a particular role? And I guess, generally speaking, the argument is not much, not in a standard quantum Hall effect. I'm not talking now about topological insulators, that's a different story, but in standard quantum Hall effect, no. But however, you do get the Zeeman effect of your spin in the magnetic field. And what is interesting is that under most conditions, the Zeeman energy, that is mu b times a, the Zeeman energy mu b times h is generally considerably smaller than h by omega c. So what that means is that it affects the filling of the states. Suppose your magnetic field is up, so that the low energy electrons are the ones with spin up. Then the first set of electrons you put in will go into the lowest Landau level with spin up. The next ones, however, will not go into the next Landau level with spin up. They'll go into the first Landau level with spin down. Okay, and it's only after you fill both of those that you'll start to fill the next Landau level. So it does affect the way in which the actual filling factor, as I've defined it, is related to the occupation of the Landau levels. And for example, let me just make one further remark there. This is the picture. This picture, first fill n equals zero up, lowest Landau level up, then lowest Landau down, then next Landau level up, etc. That works for non-interacting electrons. Not at all clear a priori, it's also going to work for interacting ones, because the interaction energy is certainly at least comparable to the Zeeman energy. Okay. And in fact, there's been a long going argument about whether the so-called nu equals 5/2 quantum Hall effect, which we'll come to in the later on Thursday next week, whether that actually is spin polarized or not. In other words, whether it corresponds to both spin populations being occupied or not. And that's not at all trivial. Certainly theoretically, to figure that out is not at all trivial, and experimentally it's not that easy to resolve either.